The search of knowledge, we must go everywhere for it. India would have achieved independence from the British Raj even without Gandhi. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. اللهم اجعل حياتي حياة صلاة وسلام على رحمتك بالسماوات والأرضين رسول رب العالمين محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أمه آمنة أم النور والسلام وعلى أبيه عبد الله ولقد أضم أمر ابن أبي كبشة ولا زاله وعلى أصحابه أجمعين وأخص بالذكر سفير محمد إلى العالمين إلى الشرق والغرب إلى الشمال والجنوب إلى الإنس والجان إمامنا ومدار سندنا إلى النور الأول وبابنا إليه أبي هريرة شارح أمنية الرسول وعلى أزواجه كلهن وأخص بالذكر أمنا ورائدتنا وإمامنا وأستاذنا وترجمان القرآن والسنة والمحكمات والمتشابهات الصديقة بنت الصديق زوج النور الأول وخليلته عاصمة الحق عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها. My main topic for today is the importance of developing a Quranic literacy. And my emphasis is on the development of Quranic literacy. Reason for the emphasis on development of Quranic literacy is that when we survey dispassionately, objectively and critically what is available or what masquerades as an education system or education systems that are available in South Africa, they fall very far short of any system of literacy, any system of comprehension. However, prior to that, I would like to look at one Sahabi of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala. My reason of looking at Abu Hurairah has absolutely nothing to do with what are current debates or current arguments and verifications between people on the personage of Abu Hurairah. My objective is an appreciation of our history and the founding fathers who established our deen. Now, this title Abu Hurairah, what does it mean? See, what is happening is that we, because of the psychosis of modernity, we are overawed by modern gadgetry. And we think that everything before us was trivial. That is not so. And when we look at Islamic history, comparatively, let us take Indian independence. India would have achieved independence from the British Raj even without Gandhi. If there was no Gandhi, the resistance of the Indian people under even then the United Congress, which was united with a broader church of Muslims, Christians, Hindus, etc., India would have still achieved independence without Gandhi. many African independencies would have been achieved without key figures. However, that does not detract from the seminal nature of all these key figures, be they Jomo Kenyatta, be they Mwalimu Julius Nyerere, etc. However, it is a sober statement without exaggeration that the Islamic triumph and its global salvation of humanity and its message of salvation to humanity, its message of freedom from liquor, interest, oppression, warfare, etc., would not have been without the genius, the blood, the sweat, the tears of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and our founding fathers, our founding mothers. Now, who is Abu Huraira and what does this title mean? Abu Huraira is a title of political office in what is called the greater Semitic milieu. And here, one thing is very important, is that the Arabic language is not a language in a ghetto. In the time of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and hundreds of years before Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Arabian Peninsula was in high, deep contact with the worlds around it. It was in contact with the Roman Empire, it was in contact with the Persian Empire, it was in contact with the Ethiopian Empire and further African centers of power to the west. Language is not a mathematical series of numbers. There is a deep osmosis, a deep cross-oxygenation between what is the so-called Arabic language and the dialects and languages around it. Now, the title Abu Huraira is understood as a diplomatic office when we read it in the context of Egyptology. The symbol of a cat in Egyptology, and Egypt was a, until today, is a point of wonder. Its architecture is still today a point of wonder. The cat was a symbol of an ambassador. That is what this title means, Abu Huraira. Now, his multiple hadiths, the multiplicity and the abundance of these hadiths originate from this high office of his, in that he was the representative of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to all and sundry. And to be this international representative, he had to have a unique genius. To interpret and to understand his hadiths, let us take one hadith. A hadith that is ill understood. In one hadith, Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala speaks and he says that salah, and he uses salah here in a political sense, it must be cancelled because of the presence of a dog, a donkey, or a woman. Now, to understand this hadith, we have to look at it politically. What Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala who is talking about is in the formative stage, Islam was a counter-revolution, or it was a revolution against the multiple layers of zulm of the Quraysh, the Roman Empire, the Ethiopian Empire, and the Persian Empire. Now, when revolutionaries are meeting, they meet with the intention of changing a political order. And those who hold that political order, their intention is always to find out who these people are, to capture them, to imprison them, or also to zero-sum them, to execute them. So the Salah Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu is referring to is a political meeting. Now in that political meeting, there is always a surveillance that takes place. That is how revolutionary politics works. Those who are meeting, they put sentries out. And what happens is those who are spying on them, they might just send a woman who's running and she says, no, I'm looking for my child. She is an intelligence operative. She wants to see who are those people meeting, and she wants to convey that information to the arresting authorities of the system of oppression. Similarly, a person can, the ruse of capture, they can let loose a donkey and a person can run and say, no, I'm just looking for my donkey. He is not looking for his donkey. What he is doing is he is trying to find out where that political meeting is taking place, who are they there, convey the information of the strength of that political meeting so that these people can be captured, exterminated, and so forth. That is the august meaning of the ahadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala. Now coming to this topic of Quranic literacy. This topic I have spoken about a few times, and I have said severally that we have failed today in the 21st century when we look at Muslim life in South Africa. We have failed dismally to achieve a high level of understanding at a comprehension level, a high level of applicative understanding, and a high level of engagement with the Quran itself. The simple test for that, these are real life examples I have seen. I have met people who hold very high offices in Islamic institutions, so-called madaris and so forth. I knew them for many, many years. Today, you visit them, you see their grandchildren, and they will talk to their grandchildren. The grandchild attends a private Greek school, and the child sings Greek songs. The child sings opening lines of Homer, the Iliad, and the Odyssey. Alhamdulillah, there's nothing wrong with them. Those are important languages, and all languages are important. We find in our leadership children who attend German private schools, and they are fluent in German, they speak German. They go overseas to continue studying in German also at high-tech German universities, alhamdulillah. We find also children who study at private French schools. They sing poetry in French, they speak French, they go and study in France, they go for holidays in France, they go for a gap year in France also. However, a question we must ask is these very same leaders of our Ummah, they hold offices in our institutions, but why is it that our children, we cannot even say they have a basal or base knowledge of Quranic Arabic. They have no knowledge of Quranic Arabic. Comparatively now, we have to come to an aggregate, a conclusion, that we do not have a system of education. Let us now look and hear towards developing Quranic literacy. I want to just read one or two paragraphs from the world of Christian education. And before I do this, I want to say one thing very importantly. We must never let this idea that we must ghetto ourselves and everything is kufr. And this is a ruse to blind us. I'll give you an example. Many, many years ago, my grandfather, these were hawkers like you see hawkers today. So they used to come from a place called Brentwood Park near Binoni. That was just a while before apartheid to buy goods. So they came to a shop, a wholesaler, who were very prominent people who held power over Islamic education, who still hold power over Islamic education. And they asked for these goods. And they said, no, we don't have it now. Come back later on. So my grandfather said, no, we'll get it from Mr. Oppenheimer, a so-called Jewish name. They said, no, in Gujarat, no, you don't have any Jawan. You must not go to them. So my grandfather then went to one of these cheap restaurants to eat and so forth. And after lunch, after Zohar, they did few other odds and ends. And they were going back to these wholesalers. And on the road, my grandfather's name was Abraham. That was how it was written. By the apartheid authorities was the anglicization of Abraham, of Ibrahim Abraham. And one of the workers in this large business concern, his name was also Abraham. So my grandfather saw Abraham on the bicycle, the goods messenger bicycle with the box in the front. So he stopped and he said, Abraham, what is here? He looked inside, he says, where you got this from? He says, I got it from Mr. Oppenheimer. And what happened is my grandfather and them went and they bought the very same thing from these people who told them, no, you mustn't go there. So the search of knowledge, we must go everywhere for it. We must not ghetto ourselves. That thing there is a ruse. It is a sinking sand. Now let us look at this book here. Understanding the Bible. The Bible is a very important book. It must be studied. It must be appreciated. One area of teaching the Bible, because the Bible is in types of Hebrew, types of Aramaic, types of Greek, types of Latin. What did the Christian world do? I'm going to read one or two paragraphs. And you as a homework, you do a comparative study and you look for anywhere in South African Islamic education a similar application of mine, a similar achievement. The preface says, the International Children's Bible is not a storybook or a paraphrased Bible. See what they say? It is not taken from an already available English translation, which is now simplified. No. It is a translation of the original Hebrew and Greek in contemporary English by international education authorities. So you see what they have done? They have taken the original sources of the Bible and they have put it into a contemporary English understandable for a person to the age bracket of 16. And this is the achievement. So so that a person, a Christian child, can have a meaningful relationship with his key text. Does such an effort exist or obtain among us vis-a-vis the Quran? I can guarantee you it does not. Let us look at something else. This is a four series set of books. This book or this series was compiled in Israel. You see, in Israel there was, and today it doesn't exist anymore, I think, or at a very minuscule level, there was something called left-wing Zionism. Left-wing Zionism had a kind of paternalistic approach or attitude to the Arabs. He said, no, we come in here, we want to stay here, so we must understand this language. We must also acquire a competence in this language. And this is a series of textbooks. If a person finishes this series of textbooks, he achieves what is called the end of intermediate modern literary competence. Now ask yourself, is there such an effort and such a level of educational achievement among us? There isn't. We fail dismally in our service to and in our allegiance to the Quran. Let us look at something else. This thing here is called a word count of modern literary Arabic, modern Arabic prose. When the Western world came to realize, when you see the picture of an American president with an Arab overgarb on a ship meeting a Saudi king, it was the realization of the hyper importance of the energy importance of the Middle East, the political importance of the Middle East, and its geostrategic importance. Now, when they realize this at the executive level, what happens? They translate it at the educational level. So what they wanted to do is to create among their intelligentsia a competence in Arabic. So what? This thing here was funded by various agencies of the American government. This is the first stage of an elaborate program. They took thousands, see all in the introduction, thousands of Arabic newspapers, thousands of pages of modern Arabic, and first they do a word count frequency, then a sentence level frequency, etc., etc., so that today their diplomats have, from the University of Georgetown, from the American University of Cairo, from the American University of Beirut, etc., etc., they have a competence in Arabic. When they have treaties with the Arab world, they supervise the Arabic text of those treaties. And on a more brutal level, you must watch the Al Jazeera documentary, Al-Musta'ribun. Al-Musta'ribun are Mossad deep cover agents. One of their key skills? Their key skills in Israel, you have the highest level of instruction in colloquial Arabic. In Arabic, there is a thing called diglossia. This is modern formal Arabic. Colloquial Arabic is something else. In Israel, they train their people with native, they call it 100% capacity in the regional dialects of the Arab world. One manifestation of that is that there's no terrorists in Gaza and all those things. There are people who are just trying to live in that prison. So anybody who tries to fix up a road or who tries to repair a broken sewage, that person is a terrorist in Gaza. So to infiltrate these places, they train their agents with 100% colloquial competence, so the person walking around can hear everything. When he's speaking to Arabs, he can speak without any doubt that he is a Palestinian. And like that, they catch people who are trying to make a better life in Al-Ghaza and in the West Bank also. This is the level of competencies that they have achieved as far as the Arab language. We must look at ourselves and we fall far short of this. We must review our education system. Not only review, we must admit that we do not have an education system. We must take some steps towards creating an education system. I want to thank you for your time, for your attention. I want to thank the officials for inviting me. I want to thank all who have been kind to me in word and material. And again, we appeal to you for your material support. Thank you very much.